Living in the age of information is both a blessing and a curse. Fake news is a household term, but the real information is out there and available.
Can you give us a question?
Can you stay categorical?
You are fake news.
Sir.
It's easy to get suckered into believing the big government, big food, and big pharma shills. One day carbs are bad, the next they're good. Meat is bad, then it's not. You shouldn't eat too much protein, you should eat way more protein. It's impossible to navigate the lies and deceit pushed on the masses by those aforementioned groups. Or is it one loosely connected group? Anyway, that's where we come in. We only look at meaningful evidence and seek to bring you guys the answers that are so desperately needed in today's world. Today, we're going to bust 8 myths pushed on the weak-minded sheep by elitists and their trillion-dollar budgets, and why...
They're just making stuff up.
Make sure you drop a like, as it really helps our small channel grow and allows us to keep making content for you guys. And subscribe if you haven't already, and hit the bell notification so you never miss a video. Myth number one, breakfast is the most important meal of the day. Simply put,
this is a load of barnacles.
They just made this up. This is a myth rooted in American culture ever since Europeans started settling in the New World. They noticed that Native Americans were just eating whenever they were hungry, not at set times, and they made them change their ways because they thought that this made them uncivilized. I guess the notion here is that eating more meals is better for fat loss since it revs up your metabolism and you'll be less likely to overeat at lunch. However, this really isn't the case. A meta-analysis looking at human experiments that varied meal frequency found that in the studies that measured it, half of them reported no change in food intake. In the studies that measured energy expenditure, none reported that increasing meal frequency increased energy expenditure, and one even reported a decrease. In the studies that measured body mass index, 11 of the 17 reported no change. For me and many others I've spoken to, they just aren't hungry in the morning and feel better when they wait till lunch or even dinner. I would say it's definitely an individual thing, but let's get this idea of breakfast being absolutely necessary for health out of here. Myth number two, lifting weights will stunt your growth. This is one of my mom's favorites. It's also a load of barnacles. If you lift too young, then you won't grow as tall. People assume that putting stress on the bones, and specifically the growth plates, could lead to injury of them, which would inhibit growth. Common sense, right?
Well, I don't believe in common sense. I believe in science. I believe in data. Perhaps you do too.
Going off of the data, if the training is done properly and not in great excess, growth plate injuries are actually more likely in more acceptable forms of exercise like baseball and gymnastics. In fact, resistance training could potentially prevent injuries by providing better balance and functional strength. It also improves bone mineral density, which is also important for growth. I'd be much more concerned about your child becoming obese or insulin resistant, both of which can be greatly improved by resistance training. Myth number three, being in the cold will give you a cold. Okay, remember back in high school. You leave the house in the morning during the winter, hair still wet, only to have one of your overbearing, uninformed parents tell you to put on a hat so you don't get sick. I guess it comes from the fact that flu rates are higher in the winter. That is why we called it a cold, right? The cold itself is a viral infection. It is true that viruses survive and travel more in colder, drier conditions, but simply being cold is not going to get you sick. This notion is disputed by the fact that there is no correlation between monthly temperature and flu infections. There are several other potential and more plausible reasons why flu rates go up in the winter. People are indoors more, meaning more close contact. Being cold impairs the immune system to a certain extent, and people get less vitamin D, another key component to the immune response. Whatever the case, the science shows that it's not the cold that gets you sick, it's the cold that makes you more susceptible to getting sick. Myth number four, you need to drink 8 glasses of water a day. This one is just ridiculous.
I know you were taught that you need to drink 8 glasses of water a day. I was taught that. Everyone knows that. That's what they say you need to do.
I mean, who came up with this? Every single person on the planet needs this exact amount of water every 24 hours. This myth was largely perpetuated by a man who was involved in the shady sugar industry lobbying at Harvard in the mid-1900s, Frederick Stare. You can learn all about that in this video we did. He said in one of his books that adults should get in about 6 to 8 glasses of water a day. This wasn't based on any scientific research, just on what he thought the helpless, naive common man should do. Now, while the last thing I would tell you to do is trust this dirtbag on anything health-related, I'll cut the guy some slack. He didn't say we all needed exactly 8 glasses a day, but that's what people say today, and that's what I'll address. Just like you shouldn't have to weigh out your food to know how much to eat, or take your temperature to know whether you should put on a jacket, you don't need to precisely calculate the amount of water to drink every day. Your need for water is dependent on a lot of things. If you eat more salt, you'll need more water to pee out the excess. If you exercise, you'll need more water to replace the sweat. How are you going to figure out how much water you need? We have this amazing power. It's almost like Spider-Man's spider sense. It's called thirst. When you feel it, drink water. When you don't, don't. I really didn't think that this needed explaining, but this is a myth that people still live by, and it's time to go. There are conditions when your sense of thirst will become dysregulated, like in diabetes or if you are severely salt depleted, but in that case, you have way bigger problems to worry about. Myth number 5, the sun will give you cancer. This one isn't entirely false, but it's been taken way out of context. People seem to think that being in the sun without sunscreen for more than 15 minutes is a death sentence. Ultraviolet radiation from sunlight can contribute to skin cancer, but only under certain circumstances. Right off the bat, it should be noted that malondialdehyde levels are significantly elevated in people that have skin cancer. Malondialdehyde is the result of UV rays acting on polyunsaturated fats. Another study took fat biopsies of 100 melanoma patients and 100 controls, and noticed a significantly higher level of omega-6 polyunsaturated fats in the fat of the melanoma patients. Looking deeper, a study in mice found that, compared to controls, mice fed a 20% corn oil diet experienced far higher rates of skin cancer induced by ultraviolet radiation. Since corn oil, like most other vegetable oils, is very high in the omega-6 fat linoleic acid, the authors concluded that linoleic acid promotes UV-initiated skin cancer. Other studies have found that diabetes and markers of insulin resistance, such as blood pressure and triglycerides, are significantly correlated with melanoma risk. Again, you can learn more about these markers in another video we did. So the saying really should be, the sun might give you cancer if you consume a lot of vegetable oil and or have metabolic dysfunction. In today's society, that's pretty much everyone, so I guess it's not a myth after all. Myth number 6, too much protein will damage your kidneys. This is one I constantly hear, eating all that protein is going to hurt your kidneys. This one comes from potentially raised levels of blood urea nitrogen, or BUN, on a high protein diet. Urea is a product of protein metabolism. With a moderate or low protein diet, a high BUN could be the result of poor kidney filtration, leaving more urea in the blood as opposed to being excreted in the urine. However, if you're simply eating more protein, of course you're going to be eliminating more urea. As this paper points out, urea clearance is a poor indicator of glomerular filtration rate, as its overproduction rate depends on several non-renal factors, including diet and urea cycle enzymes. The high BUN levels can sometimes occur during late pregnancy or result from eating large amounts of protein-rich foods. Another meta-analysis looking at 28 trials with people consuming high-protein diets found that kidney filtration rates did not change during the switch in diet. Dr. Jose Antonio is a proponent of high-protein diets and has done studies feeding individuals up to 3.4 grams of protein per kilogram of body weight. Keep in mind that the RDA for protein is just 0.8 grams per kilogram of body weight.
We actually have data showing that if you consume a high-protein diet for up to a year, and this is in trained male bodybuilders, that if you consume it for up to a year, there's no harmful effect on your kidneys, on your liver, or even your blood lipids. Everything is perfect even after a year, and we have follow-up studies showing that 2 years on a high-protein diet have no harmful effects.
Even while feeding people over 4 times the amount of protein recommended by so-called experts, the only thing that happened was that these people got leaner and put on more muscle. This is a myth that really needs to go. Protein is incredibly valuable for health and should not be feared to consume in large quantities. Myth number 7, you can only absorb 30 grams of protein per meal. This one doesn't add up from a common sense perspective. Our bodies have certainly adapted throughout our evolution to eat meals containing more than just 30 grams of protein. This myth comes from one study, which gave resistance-trained people different amounts and frequencies of whey protein. These amounts were 8 servings of 10 grams every hour and a half, 4 servings of 20 grams every 3 hours, or 2 servings of 40 grams every 6 hours. The most muscle protein synthesis happened with the 20 grams of protein, with no additional benefit above this threshold. The problem with this is that whey protein is a very fast-acting protein. It gets absorbed into the bloodstream rapidly, limiting how much of it gets utilized for building purposes and diverting the excess to be burned for energy. If you're eating whole food protein, which is more slowly absorbed, more protein can be consumed and used for muscle building. This study had people eat either 40 or 70 grams of protein in a single meal from beef and found that the higher protein group had more protein synthesis and less protein breakdown, meaning a greater net anabolic effect. These meals were matched for calories otherwise. There's also the fact that acute spikes in muscle protein synthesis, like those seen after ingesting whey, don't necessarily translate into long-term muscle gains. Personally, I've seen loads of people, including myself, put on muscle by just eating one or two high-protein meals per day. If I could only utilize 30 grams in one sitting, I would be withering away after eating one meal a day for a year and a half. Myth number 8, red wine is good for you. This is a good one. Have you ever heard of the French paradox? It's essentially the notion that the French are very healthy even though they consume a lot of saturated fat. One of the proposed reasons for this is because they drink a lot of red wine, which attenuates the harmful effects of saturated fat. Resveratrol is the main phytochemical found in red wine that is touted as having health benefits. Supplemented resveratrol in certain studies has been shown to have beneficial effects on insulin signaling, cancer formation, and longevity. It has been proposed that due to the evidence for a biological effect of resveratrol in animal studies, humans would need about 12.5 milligrams per kilogram of body weight to achieve any of these benefits. So join me as I do some math. I'm about 80 kilograms, and I need 12.5 milligrams per kilogram of body weight of resveratrol to have any meaningful effect. So this means I need 1,000 milligrams of resveratrol per day. Red wine has 0.361 to 1.972 milligrams of resveratrol per liter, so let's split the difference and call it 1.17 milligrams per liter. So if we crunch the numbers, that comes out to about 855 liters of wine per day. The standard bottle of wine is 0.75 liters, meaning I would have to drink 1,140 bottles of red wine per day to get the effect of resveratrol. Now, I'm not an expert in toxicology, but I would suspect that the harmful aspects of consuming 1,000 bottles of wine worth of alcohol would potentially outweigh the benefits of the resveratrol. But hey, maybe eating 115 pounds of tomato skin per day is more doable. Maybe the French paradox really isn't a paradox at all, and humans should be eating more saturated fat instead of industrial produced seed oils. You can learn all about that in basically every video we've ever made. Don't let them fool you, subscribe to the channel. Also, click the link below in the description to support us on Patreon.